Welcome to TPA Global Webinar. Today's webinar covers the topic, the future of intercompany financing. Today's presenters are Virinder Sharma, partner of TPA Global in Amsterdam. Virinder has an overall experience of 15 years working in the UK, India, the US, and the Netherlands. He has significant exposure to dispute resolution, including assistant clients, before commission appeals and tax tribunals. He is a regular speaker at public forums and he writes articles for international tax journals. His industry experience includes technology, automobile, financial services, pharmaceuticals, engineering services, and luxury products. Another presenter is Herbert Guevara. He is a senior transfer pricing manager at TPA Global in Amsterdam. He has worked in Big Four consultancy in the UK and Mexico. He has been involved in a number of transfer pricing planning, benchmarking, and documentation projects for multinationals in Mexico and the UK. He has experience in retail, pharmaceutical, software, consulting services, financial, and commodities industries. Dear panelists, I will give you a word.
Thank you, Mariette. So I'll give a quick brief on what we're going to cover today, and then I'll be leading the first part of this presentation, and then my colleague Albert will pick up the other part. Although the topic for today for us is intercompany, the future of intercompany financing, but it is very important for us to see intercompany financing not only from a regulatory perspective, but also from how the financial climate or how the economic conditions are changing in the world, and at the same time, how the regulatory changes in for financial institutions, how they're actually impacting companies. Because we have so far seen many times that for us, BEPS action point project by the OECD was done in October last year, and that has major implications for companies. Not only for financial transactions, but also for non-financial transactions, which is obviously correct. But there are also important bearing factors, like as I told you, that how the economic climate is changing, that is impacting companies in financial sector, that is impacting companies also in non-financial sector. And at the same time, the changes which are happening for companies who are in financial industry, like banks, other financial institutions, that will also change the dynamics of how much capital, how what interest levels will be required in intercompany financing transactions. So with that backdrop, I start with my first observation on the global economic climate. So when we look at the global economic climate, we used to have two worlds. One was the developed part of the world where we have EU, we have US, and then we have the second part, which is more about emerging markets. And both were kind of important pillar for economic growth. But as we have seen since 2008, the growth in developed world has been subdued. Many countries in Europe, they went down, some of them they went burst, and then a lot of aid was provided by ECB and IMF and World Bank. But then we see that US has recovered, US is doing better than it was doing 2 years back. And when I look at emerging markets, most of the emerging markets, they are not doing well today, except India can be taken as an exception. So when we say where the world growth is, we have to look at how the growth has moved over the last 3-4 years and where it is today and how it's going to be in the future, because that will also have an impact how the profits of companies will take shape, and that will have an impact on their borrowing capacity, what interest levels they're going to pay, not only with a third party financial institutions, but also within the group. So when I look at growth, and GDP is a good indicator to check where the growth lies in a country, is that on a worldwide basis, the GDP growth has actually, it was kind of subdued over the past couple of years, and there has been kind of a downward growth in GDP from 12, 13, 14, but in 16 we are seeing a marginal jump in GDP growth, which is projecting at 2.9%, which is higher than 2015, which was 2.6% in 2015. And 17, we are expecting slightly higher growth of 3.1%. So one when looks at this, it appears that the numbers are growing, but that is subject to how the commodity market will play, whether the commodity market, which includes minerals, which includes oil, if whether there will be a kind of upbound trend on these prices that will help all those commodity exporting countries to recover from the downturn, and then also whether the gradual tightening of financial condition, which we have already seen, whether they will have a positive impact, right? And also a great rebalancing has to happen at the China level. So keeping these factors as positive, we feel that in 16 the growth will be better than 15, and 17 it will be slightly better. And then, as I said, that will have an implication for MNEs, not only when they are borrowing from third-party financial institutions, but they also have to have different sets of terms and conditions when they have intercompany financing. Now, again, when we look at the existing economic climate, we have seen there are low investment levels. There's a weak productivity growth, and the export sector is getting smaller and smaller. When we take the example of China, which was an investment-driven economy, there with huge investments, the stock market was doing well, and it has a major portion of the growth of China. But because of that, there has been overcapacity, and overall, China has less demand for certain products, which is, for example, impacting the countries who have been exporting commodity to China. So China has overcapacity, they have less demand for raw materials, which are in terms of commodity, that is impacting other countries. So now we are moving to a world, because of excess capacity, we have low investment levels, and China is again moving to a consumption-led economy. And at the same time, we are also seeing that there are weak productivity growth, because in many countries, as we know, that the labor laws are still inflexible. So hiring and hiring is easy, possibly easy, but firing is difficult, and that creates a stickiness in the wage growth, wage levels, and it is difficult for companies to hire people on a permanent basis. And if they don't, then it doesn't create a long-term growth for those companies. Now, ECB and Bank of Japan and Federal Reserve, they are the three key players, and they try to control this economic malaise through expansionary monetary policies. Initially, the expansion of the monetary policy was limited to buying government bonds, and which was through putting more and more money into the market, and that was more like creating more money supply. But we have seen almost from 2015, we have seen more of negative rates there in the system now. So when we look at today, the central banks, they are pushing for negative rates so that the overall interest rate environment goes down. And because of that, there is an expectation that more borrowing will take place, because there will be some companies who will be needing funds. And if there is low interest rate, then possibly that would help in generating credit growth. But I believe that monetary policy is good, but at the same time, there can be some structural changes which are very important for many economies to carry. So overall, when we look at, there is a deflation, there's a low prices environment in the US, EU, and Japan. And it's primarily because there's low sentiments from the consumers, which are buying less products in the market. There's a lack of demand. And this lack of demand is leading to lower price levels. And then when we have low price levels, then we have low profits for the company. And when these companies, they have low profits, they do less hiring or they do more firing. And then again, low profits. And then again, it's a vicious cycle. And it is difficult for companies to come out of that. And a push for a greater monetary expansion. But as I mentioned earlier, some structural changes have to happen in terms of changing in labor laws. Some new investment have to happen in high growth industries that could possibly complement the monetary expansion and bring changes in the global market. Another area which we have seen, which is impacting the global market, is climate change. When we look at climate change, yes, the G20 has signed up to curbing poisonous gas which are impacting environment, but at the same time, it is also impacting how the financial institutions will fund companies who are responsible for damaging the climate. There has been recent news that JP Morgan will not stop direct financing to new coal mines and new coal power plants. So if that is happening, then all those companies which are part of that industry, they will have difficulty in getting the required level of financing, which means that either they have to pay a higher interest rate or possibly should have some collateral. So that could also impact the intercompany financing in those industries which are not getting enough financing because of the climate change.
Brianda, that's a really interesting overview that you have provided. And indeed, if we focus on the topic of our presentation, which is the future of intercompany financing, it is always important to look at the past, at the present, in order to be able to forecast the future. So given the facts that you have just mentioned, what do you think will be the impact on the future of intercompany financing?
But that's a very good question, and to answer your question, we have to look at what the trend has been in the global market. So as we know that the downturn mainly started in 2007-2008, and there has been quite low growth in many countries in various parts of the world. But when I look at the period from 11-12, the GDP, the overall world GDP has gone down, but now it is expected by World Bank that for 16 and 17, the GDP growth will pick up. But if the GDP growth pick up, obviously GDP of world at world level is nothing but how the companies are going to grow. If companies are going to grow, they have better profits. I would imagine that the leverage position of companies, corporates will improve. And if that improves, possibly one can argue that the intercompany financing at the required rates will prevail. But if the companies will continue bleed, which I expect for another year or so, then the companies, they have to revisit their intercompany financing arrangements to check, are they really exposed because of bleeding balance sheet? But I don't think that there can be a sudden change in next 1 year. But I think if I look at the 2 to 3 years time span, I would imagine that the growth rate should rebound, because we have already seen the price of oil has rebounded, but it's too difficult to say, whether that's a structural change. But, I'm looking more for structural changes, and so far we have seen a lot of monetary expansion at EU level, but I still feel that 2 to 3 years time frame would be reasonable time frame when companies have better profitability to grow.
In order for companies to grow, they certainly require funds to promote investment, funds to promote acquisitions, developing new technologies. And if we focus right now, Brianda, perhaps in the last 12 months or so, I've seen the trend of the central banks and also countries on placing very low interest rates or even going below zero. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yes, again, that's another good question, Abbott, and that's what my next slide is going to cover. Now, when we look at funding, funding has two elements. One element is the amount of funds I need, and the second element is what interest are going to pay for that. And the first, we say that it defines a leverage position. Second, the capacity to pay, which we say that how much interest I have to pay. Now, in my career, for almost 30-14 years of my career, I've never seen negative interest rates. that was kind of unheard. I've never heard in my professional career that in the past that if I have to put my money in bank, I have to pay for that. That's what the world we are into. So if I look at now, when I look at the negative interest rate levels, where are we now? First, we have to check that, and then we will have an answer to the question, that important question you raised, how this overall interest level is going to impact me or corporates in the next 1-2 years. Minus 0.40%, which is the negative interest rate which ECB brought to this level recently. When I look at Switzerland, minus 0.75. And you know the reasons why this is so, because Swiss economy is doing well. There has been a lot of money which is flowing into Switzerland. They moved away from the pact with euro, and suddenly there was a huge appreciation. So they thought bringing to negative will depreciate currency, but that is not happening because investors still feel that Swiss is a kind of safe place to put money. Sweden, minus 0.5. Japan also follow ECB footstep in January. They brought their interest rate to minus 1.0. Then Denmark was the pioneer in bringing negative interest rates. It's almost 3 to 4 years back. And even Denmark, it's kind of minus 0.7%. Denmark is even now starting charging corporates to pay for the money. If they put money in banks, the corporates have to pay money for putting their money in the banks. So why I have picked up all these minus rates just to share with the audience and with you also that this negative interest rate means that there is a kind of a feeling that there are not enough borrowers for the funds in the market. There is not enough demand for this funds in the market. And through these negative interest rates, the central banks are trying to do two things. One is to make their currency depreciated so that investors will not invest much in the country. Currency depreciate, inflation goes up, and you know there are positive sentiments, profit goes up, everything is happy. All companies are happy, governments are happy. Second element is that they also want to encourage borrowers to take more funds so that they have make investment, they have put money on projects, and they do hiring, people get money, they buy more stuff, and then you know the whole cycle will go up. But the challenge is that we are living in a world of excess capacity. So although we do have negative interest rates, but there is not enough demand for that money in the market. So if you look at now, most of the money which is gone is in buying government bonds. So only if the money is actually borrowed by corporates in a big way, and especially by mid-sized corporates, then yes, we can say the growth will return. But if I look at these negative numbers, it always makes me to feel that the interest levels will not go up. But it's a very good environment. Like, you know, we are seeing mortgage, you know, financing is going up. It's good for economies where, you know, borrowers can buy at a low rate. But the governments, they have to make structural changes in their economies. They have to bring out new investment, high technology investment, which increase productivity. They should have better labor laws. All those type of changes they have to bring. That's how they can complement it. But I can tell you, if we just follow the expansionary monetary policy, it's just if we follow this for a long-term basis, it not only damage banks in terms of what margin they're going to earn, but it will also impact the overall market because the sentiments will be low. And if the inflation rate is still kind of, it goes negative, it becomes deflation. These negative rates will be kind of positive rates in the real terms. So I feel that a lot of structural changes are required, and unless though they happen, I don't think, you know, we can see a big change happening in the world. But now back to the question, how this is going to impact my intercompany financing. If I have already have these low level of rates and keeping in mind the regulatory changes in financial industry, which you're going to discuss, they will definitely bring the overall interest level down to a low level. Right, and possibly one can also see the rates or the yields going up in risky investments like junk bonds because of loss or low profits for banks or for fund institutions or for investors in less risky areas where you're going to have negative or zero interest. There'll be more tendency to go for high risky assets, high risky investments. So you would see that there could be a big gap between the low risky investments and high risky. So interest rates on like junk bonds, they will go up. So if I have some intercompany dealing where it's very risky, then I can expect high interest rate, but that has to be supported by a stronger balance sheet of the borrower within intercompany.
Miranda, I have a question. If I, because you know, within the audience, I can see that we have CFOs, we have also treasurers, and people probably from the finance department of a multinational, and they're listening to you now, and they listen to you saying, it looks like the interest rates would stay low. And the question, and you know, they're also looking at repricing some of their intercompany financial arrangements, long-term loans or short-term loans, or even for cash pools, intermediary financing entities. Maybe it is a time to go back to those arrangements and come up with something new. But then the sub-zero interest rate, is it going to be something staying for the short term? Is it something more for the long term? How do you see that?
But I think I would take this more as a structural change. And I can tell you that it's not just short-term change in interest levels. Structurally, the interests have gone down. When I look at, I'm from India, so you know, when I call people, my clients there, or when I speak with the financial institutions in India, they say 7%, 8%, 9%, 10%. Those level of interests are there, and they have been there for quite a long time. But when we look at this part of the world, when we are in Europe, you'll agree with me that these subdued rates are there for so long. Inflation has been below 2% target of the EU. So they are not even close to their target. So I feel that there's already a structural change in interest level, general interest levels. For example, if you even talk to a normal household who wants to take a mortgage loan, the interest rate levels are freezed at 2% for the next 10 years. So that means this overall general feeling that there's a structural change of the lower interest rate. So back to your point, wherever I have in my intercompany loans, keeping the regulatory changes on financial industries aside, which you're going to discuss, I would imagine that the interest levels will go down. But at the same time, considering the changes in tax from BEPS, you have to ensure that there's enough capital with the borrower, and there's enough functionality in the borrower who can pay it, but overall interest levels will go down. So today, when I calculate a risk for putting equity at risk for a flow through, for example, my return on equity has gone down because we use certain interest rates in the market, interest rate, risk free interest rate. So overall, there has been a structural change in interest rate. So I would imagine that the intercompany interest rate would also go down. It's not short term, but if I have a long term intercompany loan, which is already there, then I have to revisit I have to look at for refinancing. If I have short term arrangements, they will anyway will be reflected through continuous changes which are happening in financial system.
Okay, Miranda. And so going a step a little bit forward, which is the implications. So if the interest rate would continue being long, however, the economy in some parts of the world, like the EU you mentioned, is starting to slightly grow. The US is recovering a little bit faster than India, for instance. You have the economy stable and continue growing, and that's why probably you have the interest rates. What would be the implications? Because these implications in the end should be considered by the treasury departments of multinationals, also for in-house banks. They should be considered because, again, in terms of planning. What would be the implications in your view?
Yes, so that's would be my next slide, where, you know, here I'm talking about implications. Now that's what, you know, the most relevant thing, how it's impacting my intercompany financing. So I'll take one example. If and India, why India is growing, India has its own reason why, you know, the growth is happening. It's not so much export dominated country, and that's kind of an outlier within emerging markets. So I will not go into all those details, but if I have a borrower in India who needs funds from a related party, and that related party is, say, in EU, and where the interest level are so low, but in India, the interest levels are high. But obviously, you have to make for adjustment for movement in foreign exchange. There are country risk adjustments you have to make. But when you agree interest rate between lender and borrower, generally there is negotiation. So if the rates were higher in the EU, then I compare it today, overall expectation of the interest will be lower now, even for a borrower in India. So Now, what implications these economic climate has on overall on intercompany financing is that one is that it is putting many intercompany loans underwater. And when I say underwater, why? So first implication of this poor economic climate is poor profitability for corporates. So once they're poor profitability, they will have a difficulty in paying back their interest and principal. So if we have companies, corporates who have low profitability, if their equity is being eroded, then one has to really see that whether there's enough paying capacity at the borrower level. So one has to revisit their balance sheet, because it's definitely impacting many companies. Another example is that climate change example I mentioned. If a financial institution are not giving you enough loan, right, to your sector, then all those companies, they will have difficulty in getting funds. And at the same time, that will also have an impact if they are going for intercompany lending or borrowing, because you have to reflect what the market reality is. So definitely, it is impacting the companies, how they're going to pay it, and this is the time when company has to revisit their intercompany arrangements. Second is that, as I mentioned, that this poor profitability is making company highly leveraged, because I have low profits, I have to expand business, I have to make sure that my shareholders are happy, I have to pay dividends, I go for more debt, I become more leveraged. So it's a kind of a vicious circle which I'm unable to come out. So that is also again going to impact intercompany financing, where they have to check their leverage positions. Now, and as I mentioned to you earlier, that negative interest rate is creating an overall low level of interest environment for intercompany loans. So this is impacting the intercompany interest rates. This is also impacting, for example, if I have to calculate return for an intermediary financing entity. And this will also impact the treasury setup, where I have a treasury setup, which is kind of an in-house bank, where it keeps a spread for its functionality. So if I'm seeing that the overall borrower market and lenders market, they're being impacted, they could also have implications for the spread as we keeping as a treasury in-house bank. Another important point is that many companies or financial institutions, they are moving to risky ventures like junk bonds. I was doing a case for one of my clients, and this was a hybrid loan. And there, as you know, that in hybrid loan, generally the interest, you have a fixed interest rate, and you have some share of profits which they take as a return. There, it's a kind of a risky investment. But when I have to compare, when I have to look for low interest rate on subordinate loans, then interest rates are kind of pretty low. But when I go to junk bonds, which is a risky investment, there has been some kind of upward activity on junk bonds, especially in the US. The yields are going up because, you know, people are investing more on junk bonds because they see that's a good opportunity for them to earn, because there's a depth of opportunity of earning good return in the market. And another point which is one has to, the companies they need to keep in mind is that what covenants, when they have to look at covenants, paying interest has been a very important covenant. So if you default on paying interest, then suddenly, you know, the banks, they will call their money back. But today, the question which is being discussed is that when I have a zero interest level in the market, then is non-payment of interest is really a covenant anymore? Because the only covenant would be like I should pay my debts on time, but obviously there can be other covenants like how much profits I have, what's my EBITDA cover, because I have to repay principal also. So overall, these changes are impacting intercompany arrangements. The companies must revisit their contracts which they already have, if they are having for the last 4 to 5 years. Relook at their intercompany clauses to their intercompany agreements, and then accordingly they have to revisit it. And secondly, and most importantly, they also have to revisit their financing, what price they agreed in the past. And if there is already a very high interest rate on intercompany loans, they have to revisit and readjust it based on the new economic environment.
Indeed. a very interesting analysis of how the economy has been happening lately and what we see happening in the future. And perhaps it's time for us to start talking about the regulatory aspects and what we have seen in terms of the theoretical part and also from the practical part. In terms of the, you know, if we could pay close attention to why the audience is listening to us today, it's probably because they're looking, okay, I have heard enough about BEPS, I have heard enough about the economy and how the financial industry is behaving. I understand that over the last years, 2008 and also before 2002, it is the finance, it is banks and financial institutions the source of all this mess. And because of that, there needs to be more regulations, and those regulations some have impacted the supply and demand of funds and the cost of borrowing funds, et cetera, et cetera. The question that I think most of our audience should have is, if you take into account all of this, what should I do? And the problem is, in my view, is that if we focus on BEPS, we can see in our slide, we can see what BEPS is expecting from the audience and from multinationals. They're expecting to run some type of benefit test. BEPS has telling you about that there will be a maximum cap of deductibility for the whole group, and that should be applied for the group companies also. There should be some substance. There should be value creation, there should be avoidance of hybrid mismatches, and so on and so on. But there's one thing, Brianda, that I think that BEPS has not touched upon, or even the OECD, is, you know, how to price intercompany arrangements. What should be the correct level of capital that an entity should have, either the borrower or the lender, in order to enter into these financial arrangements? The pricing of guarantees. You know, right now, companies are growing, but at some point, some of them, they may be highly leveraged. There will be a high risk of going default, but there should be a guarantee in those financial arrangements. And again, if we look at all the theoretical things that are out there, it's just that, it's just theory. There's nothing practical. So again, if to our audience, we either have companies who are very interesting on how to price intermediary financing entities, or if it's a cash pool, or if it's a long-term loan, you know, a short-term loan, for participation loan. That's the question that I think they have. And they have, okay, where can I look for? Where can I find some information?
And I think you picked up a very important point, because today, you know, you attend every next webinar, you talk to policymakers. Everywhere you hear about substance, how many people do I have? Where do I have significant people function? And that's important, you know. If you don't have anybody in your company, then you cannot expect to earn high returns, because there should be a people function which should be there, and which is obviously very clear to many corporates. But the key thing is that how I gonna price it, and when I start discussing on that how I gonna price it, all these things will become part of my analysis. Then, how I gonna price it, I have to check my balance sheet, as you said. I have to look at my capital, as you said, and then but when I have to look at that's the financial side, but then I have to ultimately, most of my analysis, I have to compare myself with comparables. And when I do that, then yeah, obviously my functionality, you know, will come in play. So I think I'm looking, this more look like a top-down approach where I know the problem, I start from there, and then when I start building on it, then all those things will fall under that. I think that kind of approach, do you think that does that save time for corporates? Because obviously, compliance is important, but at the same time, it should not result in too much administrative burden on corporates.
That is correct. And, you know, the key question is again, where can I find comparables? And even if you have those databases come from transactions that are usually between a financial institution and just a multinational. And you have loan connector database, for instance. So if you look at it right now, you know, since 2014, probably, the banking industry and the financial industry has been heavily scrutinized. You know, after 2008, second time that the world goes down, just because of how corporates, how banks and financial institutions are structured and how they structure their financial arrangements. Now there is a closed loop trying to make sure that the regulations are in place. And in my view, if we take into account how these financial institutions will be regulated and are being regulated, perhaps the head of treasury of an in-house, the CFO, the finance department of a multinational that are paying close attention to us, they can use it as a benchmark of saying, where should I focus going forward? So again, we go back to the title, the future of intercompany financing is about that, where to focus. So in my view, there will be companies who need to focus on their capital requirements, at least banks and financial institutions that are heavily regulated in that specific area. So the old levels of low capital or high leverage, they're basically forgotten. They also have to have liquidity ratios. So they need to look up on what the liquidity ratios are. They also need to look about categorization of their financial transactions. You have intermediate financing entities. So that's one type of financial arrangement, but you also have cash flows and just the traditional long, short-term loans. But under each of these profiles, there's a different functions, risk, and assets. So in my view, there's the type of requirements for these three different types of profiles should be different. How much capital should an SPV, so an intermediary financing entity, should have, an entity acting as cash flow, and so on. The level of risk, the level of functions, and depending on that, there will be an arm's length compensation. You know, I'm not saying anything different. That's what the OECD says. That's what the transfer pricing guidelines mention.
And Abbott, it's very interesting to see this, how, you know, the changes in financial regulation going to give some reference points for intercompany financing. But when I look at this, all these changes are for financial institutions. You know, some of them, they're very significant, too big to fail, for example. And then others are, you know, they would like, the policymakers would like banks to, should not, in the future, the normal public should not bail out, taxpayers should not bail out banks. But it makes me to feel that all these changes would possibly be relevant for those intercompany transactions where the intercompany and where that entity within the group is more like a treasury, more like an in-house bank. Because when in many cases, I see intercompany loans are between two operating entities. So there, my financial activity is not my main business. But is it right to say that these changes would be more relevant for treasury type of setup, or do you think they're going to be applicable across board?
It will depend on the profile. I think that again, if we go back to how the financial industry has been regulated, banks, it would take banks as the again as the supply where the money is being supplied. We see banks as the benchmarks. So we try, that would be my comparable. So I would try to use banks, and again, how are they regulated? And what is happening now is that you have a series of new rules. So you have the EU Capital Requirement Directive and also regulations. You have the prudential regime. And these two types of directives are prescribing what should be the categorization of banks or institution acting as banks. And depending on the categorization, there will be a different requirement for capital, for liquidity ratio, for an analysis of credit risk, market risk, even of guarantee schemes, because that's one key point that policymakers are trying to tackle, that in the event that banks fail, you mentioned, you know, they are too big to fail, but that was said about Citigroup many years ago, and you know the story. So what policymakers are trying to avoid is that it happens. So if it happens, at least there should be a guarantee in place, sort of like deposit of last resource. So again, my suggestion would be to look at how banks and financial institutions are being regulated, how depending on their profile, and at least when it comes to prudential regime is suggesting that there are different categories of financial institutions, and depending on the category, there will be a specific level of capital, liquidity, and so on. So perhaps multinationals should look at that again as a benchmark. So go back to prudential, look at the categorization of these profiles and try to see where they fit in. And wherever they fit in, they will find a definition of, again, what the capital level should be, what the guarantee level should be, and so on. And those are official references, which, again, right now they don't have.
Yes. Well, again, and back to my same point which I made just now, is that when I have an intercompany loan, in a group, where there's a lender and there's a borrower, and you know, they charge interest based on the obviously the credit worthiness of the borrower, and all that analysis is done. We run a search on loan connector and we find interest rate, and we also check the credit rating of the borrower. when I, these are the typical situations I see in the intercompany loans. So when I look at these regulatory changes, they are more on the requirement of capital, or that, for example, the financial institution has to keep some capital as a kind of a liquid capital. They have to invest in government security. So I was hearing that it could be 45% or something, but more capital banks have to keep. So that means that maybe a year later, if I go to Loan Connector, I would imagine that there would be change in interest at which the banks are lending to corporates, for example, because they have to keep more capital, somewhere they have to earn return. So do you think there can be change in interest rates which are available on databases, and because of that, that will also impact my intercompany financing rates?
There would be indeed a change, but I think the main issue will be the margin. I think that the margin that financial institutions will be obtaining going forward will be quite slim compared to the honorous margins that they were making in the past. Why? Because again, if there is a new law prescribing a higher level of capital and liquidity, that means that there is more restriction on the amount of funds that the bank can pull in from the market and then try to unlend it. And even if they try to unlend it, they need to make sure that there are guarantees to secure that in the event of default, those funds can be paid back to the entities that we're using as depositors, so those that are providing funds to the bank. So what we're going to see in the benchmarks that we do is we're going to see, again, in my view, that the cash pool will probably earn a lower margin, right? We were talking at the beginning, like you mentioned, that low interest rate would probably stay for the 1-2 years, but then probably that's what you can expect for a benchmark if you try to price a loan for the years going forward. Perhaps it's going to be a low interest rate. On the other hand, the deposit rate would also be low. So what does that, and the compliance cost will be much higher. So what does that mean to you? Immediately, it means that the spread that you can expect as an in-house bank, as a cash pool, for instance, or even as an intermediary financing entity, will probably be quite slim. So again, going back to where should I focus, probably I shouldn't focus on changing the benchmark. Probably the way of doing benchmark is going to be the same. What I think that tax authorities will be paying close attention to will be more as to the level of capital, the levity of liquidity, how companies are defining their risk as absorbed by the entities acting as treasury house. There will need to be a clear definition of, okay, these are the risks that I'm assuming, and these are how I'm quantifying those risks. And based on that quantification, this is the compensation that I should get. And what my clients will be asking is like, okay, where can I get information in that regard? It sounds interesting. Well, my suggestion would be if they look at the EU capital requirements and regulations and the directive number 4, there is a clear indication of Basel III. So there you can listen a little bit more about the progress made, again, on capital requirements. You can also look at the prudential regime for classification of financial institutions, depending on the risk they assume. And also based upon that, the capital and solvency that they should have. And also there is a definition on the types of risks that a financial institution should be undertaking, depending on the risk profile and the quantification. So I wouldn't be surprised if tax authorities start looking at from that angle, saying, okay, if we use banks and financial institutions as benchmarks, if we look at the prudential regime, if we look at CRR and CDR, if we take those regulations as basis, so maybe we should try to insert them also in the area of transfer pricing. And the focus, again, will be on capital. How much capital? What should be the correct level of capital? What should be the level of liquidity? And I think that's what the company should be focusing on.
Yeah. And again, I think you have replied wonderfully, Ebert. My next point of discussion would be that all this do give me what capital level I need to have. And I know that all these regulations, they are for full-fledged players in financial industry. And I know that these changes would be very relevant for treasury setup. But this is about numbers, about capital, how much heavy balance sheet I need to have. But can these regulations also help a taxpayer to understand the comparables and to understand its functionality, to understand various layers of function and risk? For example, when we look at today, the transactions, intercompany transaction in finance, we look up to the OECD guide, 2010 guidance on for permanent establishment. it has given a lot of literature on how you evaluate intercompany financing. You have loan origination, loan management, and that's how you have a lot of, because we don't have any specific regulation by OECD on financial regulation. So that's the only kind of important document for us. So what's your take that, can we also use these regulations for defining, understanding our function assets and risk in today's time?
That is correct, Firanda. And like you mentioned, so far the only source of information that multinationals can get in terms of assessing the functional and risk profile for financial transactions is the report on permanent establishments. Okay, there's really no guidance provided so far on any of the 15 BEPS action plans. BEPS action plan number 4 states that this year, or perhaps 2017, there would be some guidance provided on the application of analysis for intragroup financial transactions. But in the meantime, there's nothing. So at least if you're looking for, if you as a treasury house, if you as a CFO, as a finance manager, is looking for official information on, again, how to define your risk profile, how to quantify the risk, I would say, look at these official financial resources. These are at the bank level. These are at the EU level, and some of them even at an international level. Whether you are a bank or an entity that is acting as a bank, a credit institution, or again, even an investment, acting in investment activities, if you look at the two sources that I mentioned, you will find the definition. You will find some official reference. So whenever there is a transfer pricing audit, you can go back and cite these official sources to the tax auditor.
And you also mentioned about prudential regime.
The prudential regime,
the 8
that
to 10,
is correct.
You mentioned that for 8 to 10 categories.
That is correct.
That means if I have that, so many multiple layers, which can cover a whole range of functionality on financing within intercompany, right?
That is correct. I mean, the perhaps the most interesting thing would be trying to explain all this complex evolution of the regulation of the financial industry to the tax auditor. But at least you will be in a better off position. The tax auditor most likely will try to just use, again, the PE guidance that is provided on financial transactions, but that's it. And some benchmarks on from, again, databases. But I think that you have a higher chance to have the winning hand when you can go back and say, hey, this is how the banking industry is much more complex than what I am doing, but I'm trying to compare myself to that to a certain level. You mentioned that in the past there should be some adjustments, correct, but this is a good starting point. A much stronger starting point. And again, focus first on capital. What should be the correct level of capital that a company should have? Also the liquidity ratios, the credit and market risk. That's also two very key important. And if you need some analysis on, again, of some source of information, on how to price them, you can certainly go to these two references. And if I look at this slide, for instance, I am comparing it to a tennis match. So on the one hand, you have the international regulatory bodies. They are enacting new laws. And on the other hand, you have the banks and other financial institutions. Back in time, if you see the circle would be regulations, would be many regulations. As you can see from the left, the circle was really small. So that means that regulations, there was not that many regulations in place. But as time goes by, there will be more regulations as a reflection of, again, all the mess that has happened in the past, due to the underperforming and not transparency of financial institutions. So there are more and more regulations in place. Either it comes from the OECD, or it comes from the World Bank, or it comes again from the Central Bank of Europe, and so on and so on. So what this picture is trying to tell is that the ball will be continue to grow. So the two players here, you have again international regulatory bodies, and the other at the bank and other financial institutions. The ball of regulations or containing regulations would be so big that financial institutions won't be able to go around it, to find loopholes, to say, oh, sorry, I missed the ball. It was too small. I wasn't aware of that regulation. Right now, there's so much literature about what is happening, again, about how financial institutions will be regulated, that's what we're trying to show them to our audience. So they're fully aware of what's happening now, and they can try to transpose it to how they're doing their future in the company financial arrangements. In the meantime, you have, again, from one side, the multinationals, so the Treasury Department, and on the other hand, you have the tax authorities. They're just as spectators. They're watching the game, So how does the two players, financial institutions, and on the other hand, the regulatory bodies, how they play in this game? Who's the winner? Who's the loser? And how the evolution of these regulations takes place? So that's what my suggestion is. Take that as a reference. Don't take it as a law carved in the stone, but take it as a point of reference and try to use it and extrapolate it to your intercompany financial arrangements.
Now, I have a very important point which a tax director or a CFO will think of is, what about how much cost I'm going to incur to complete my intercompany financing documentation? I have to be pragmatic, but at the same time, I have to comply with law. Now, when I look at this ball, and this ball looks like to me a football field now, not a ball. So for me, when I look at this, there's too much regulation. So am I traveling into a different world where I have to even look up to these changes in financial regulation? But yes, I feel that to the extent where the stakes are high, where the values of transactions are very high, and you know, these type of knowing these changes will only help me in designing my intercompany pricing in advance and properly. Because if, because of the time or cost, I ignore them, somehow they will be definitely be reflected in financial databases.
That is correct.
They have to, because as you said, capital, as I said, economic climate. So they will be reflected in databases. So if today a taxpayer, you know, although it requires time, if we are not aware of, you know, these changes, then suddenly after a year, I will find that I'm actually really underwater.
That is correct.
That means again, I have to revisit my financing, make, you know, retrospect changes, and that has its own peculiarities and problems.
That is correct. And I think that one of the first conclusions that we can draw upon, Miranda, is that you need to first make sure that the house is well structured. And by house, I mean your transfer pricing system around financial arrangements. You cannot go and start pricing loans, guarantees, and other type of financial arrangements before having the right structure. Again, and by right structure, my suggestion is look at capital requirements, look at liquidity ratios, and the other risks that the other two risks that I mentioned. Make sure that those are clearly identified, that they are clearly defined to your case, again, depending on the profile that you have. Make sure that you have it. Once you have that set up, then try to come up with what would be the ultimate pricing of the financial arrangements. By the time that you look at the databases, it should be reflected also. But make sure that first you touch upon, again, the base, the sole basis. Without having a solid base of your transfer pricing system, then there are higher chances that even though the interest rate may sound feasible because you just extracted from a database, it may as well be that, again, the level of capital, you know, it's not there. And we saw it, you know, 2 years ago when there are the new regulations in the Netherlands, for instance, for intermediary financing entities. One of the key issues was substance. Fine, that's going to be tackled by BEPS. But the second one is, what's the correct level of equity that should be there to add some substance? Well, that touches upon exactly what we're talking about. What's the right level of equity, of capital, solvency, liquidity?
Yeah, I'm in total agreement with you, Albert, that this is the right time for companies to look at how the economic changes in economic climate going to impact the intercompany financing. And changes in financial regulations also, it's already there, it's evolving. And the company should look at what changes are happening, use them for their pricing their intercompany as a starting point, and which will also help when they're doing compatibility analysis in terms of getting right tools and knowledge. How to evaluate function assets and risk, because there's literature also available in this financial regulation. But when we look at the current situation now, it will be important for corporates to check whether their existing positions are highly leveraged or not, in terms of whether they, if they are having low profits, is that really exposing them because they didn't revisit their intercompany financing. And I have myself seen in certain cases where they're more like hybrid structures, the interest rates are more than 30%, right? So in today's time, it will be very difficult to justify anything beyond 10% unless there's substance, unless we can get some clues from those financial regulations, which means that if I'm an investor, or if I'm more like an investor, I provide funds, then am I also participating in certain functions? So my reward is not only for providing funds, there's a much also some added functionality to that. So it, So possibly in certain cases where the rates are very high, I may have to move to a pocket split approach rather than just applying a cup, finding interest rates. So in today's time, it's too difficult to find, at least, you know, in another 1 year or 2 years time, to find higher interest rate levels. And next is another important things we are seeing when we talk to tax authority is that we are seeing that the companies, they follow synthetic approach, which means they, we do benchmarking, we do it on, say, a loan connected database, we find comparables, we say these are the comparables, best available comparables, that's the interest rate, and we do it. But less emphasis has been spent on people function. But in today's context, what we discuss is that for me, the main driver is that how I will be able to calculate my intercompany pricing. Whether do I have right capital or not? Can I pick up something from financial regulation? And then at the same time, that all this helped me in understanding whether I have enough people function or not. And at the same time, the company should also have enough audit rate, especially when you have a hybrid structure, which will anyway, you know, dying the natural death. If taxes are not paying in one of the countries, if there is no taxation, then there is anyway those structures will die their natural death. But at the same time, in all those structures where interests are very high, it's important to build an audit trail. That will be very key for an audit trail has to be built. This is not a new concept. It has been there for quite some time, but it will become all the more important, especially in this declining interest rate and poor profitability. And another point which I want to make is that one has to, again, as I mentioned, that one has to check existing financial structures, especially if there are profit participation loan, because they are already on high radar now, especially after that action point and hybrid structure. So one has to really make sure that in the current situation, are they not being taxed anywhere? And at the same time, is there a wider functionality by the investor? Is it just only funding or much beyond that? For example, if I provide funds for acquiring an IP, then am I also participating in the development of that IP? So it's more like a profit split approach. A company may need to follow that.
Exactly, and it's about the economics of the transactions. What is the background and the rationale for entering into that transaction? And one thing that we also want to suggest to our audience is to focus on the industry analysis, but not really of, you know, the if it's a manufacturing sector, if it's a distribution sector. It's more about the banking sector in the countries of the parties to the transaction, so the lender and the borrower, because that can give you an indication of how the interest rates, the cost of the opportunity cost. What's the opportunity cost for the local borrower to borrow from its own country, as opposed to the opportunity cost of borrowing from an intercompany transaction that is located in another country. So sometimes when doing that detailed analysis of the banking system, of the countries, of the entities participating in the financial transaction, that can already give you an indication if the company interest rate that you're trying to apply is something that can be supported. So if the bank is trying to have a stricter monetary policy, and because of that, is trying to, for instance, regulate the amount of money available in the market, of course that will have an impact on your interest rate. But if you just try to go to a benchmark, which is just a few data points out there, those data points sometimes are not a reflection of the countries of the lender and the borrower. The transactions are outdated, are a completely different industry. So use that benchmark, but also try to complement it with, again, a thorough analysis of the banking and financial industry of the parties to the transaction.
Absolutely right. And, you know, this is a kind of this is a thing which is there in the system for so many years. I have seen in many situations, we have one-sided approach where we just benchmark the borrower country.
Right.
But, you know, it should be two-sided, not in the sense of office split, but two-sided analysis, especially where the financing transaction amounts are very high, to check from the investor side, or the lender side and borrower side, both, because ultimately it boils down to what bargaining they carry while they are agreeing on sacrificing.
That is correct. I think that with this we have finalized our conclusions for this webinar.
Dear participants, you can ask your questions in the chat box or in the questions box. Please feel free.
It looks like for now we cannot receive any more questions.
I think I can spot one. The question is that how do you see the intercompany financing in emerging markets, do you think there are enough databases available to justify a good analysis? Because I think this is a very important question, but I think what the audience is trying to say is that all these financial regulations which we're discussing about, how does that really pan out for companies from the emerging market?
Yeah, indeed, at least in my experience, for Southeast Asia, for instance, or Latin America, the African countries, there's not such really a local database. Usually it is a database extracting information from developed countries. So you have between American-based companies, British or Australian, the really largest banks, but usually it is a transaction between those largest banks and multinationals from the US, Canada, and the developed world. So to what extent that information will be a true reflection of an entity located in an emerging market, I think, you know, you can certainly question, and that will be a question to be raised even by the tax inspector and even by the taxpayer sometimes. So what at least I have done in the past is I look at the statistics published by the local banks, also by the national banks of these countries. There is significant information. Unfortunately, some of this information is in the local language, so there can be a language barrier. But if that's not the case, there are statistics, and those statistics show information for small and medium-sized enterprises, large enterprises, and there is also sometimes for credit risk, purpose of the financial transaction, date of the financial transaction. And I am more inclined to use that type of information, apply some adjustments, and have a higher degree of comparability to what we're trying to defend or benchmark, as opposed to, again, just going and using databases, which information is not comparable at all to your case.
Yeah, thanks. And the next question is that how Action 4 would impact intercompany financing? Yes, you know, we have Action 4, which gives a kind of a limit. And within that limit, you know, the taxpayer will have its interest rates. But at the same time, that means that the functionality is still important. That means that one has to still look at the regulatory changes in economic climate, because where the companies will fall in terms of the intercompany pricing, one will still have that leeway considering the Action 4 point.
We have a final question from Hendrik, I believe. Do you see resistance of tax departments in applying higher margins in negative interest countries for intercompany loans? I think that at least if that would be the case, again, the negative interest rates are usually applied for banks. So between financial institutions, that's what it's applying. So far, it's not really being applied to corporates to that extent. And even if it is applied, it is applied depending on a threshold. So depending on the certain amount of loan. So that's when you can apply. But I don't see it to the extent that, again, we look at what's the economics behind that. So why would you like to apply a higher interest rate than go against market conditions? And that would be my key message. First, understanding what is the rationale. It can be the credit risk, and the credit risk is something completely atypical, and then you need to support it and quantify it. It can be, like I mentioned, the capital requirements of the borrower. It can also be the liquidity ratios of the borrower, think capitalization also, the purpose of the loan. Those are at least four or five criteria that you can take into account, and then try to benchmark against, you know, what you see on the market. Without that information, without that thorough analysis, then you can certainly see a high resistance for tax authorities to accept going against the market conditions.
Well, I you know, what the factors you mentioned, they are very important, and I'm in total agreement with you, but overall I see there has been a structural shift in interest rates. So if there was some audit which was going 3 years back, for 4 or 5 years back, definitely in that audit, you know, there would have been a high tendency to get high interest rates. But when I look at today audit, if they happen for say 15 or 16, 2 or 3 years down the line, I would imagine that the overall expectation of interest would be lower. There is a structural shift, but yes, at the same time, one has to look at specific facts, what risk I'm carrying, whether I have enough capital, whether I'm over leveraged, and one has to really go through different parameters to actually conclude that whether what level interest rate is right for this borrower.
That is correct. I believe this was the last question, but if there will be further questions in the screen, you can find our contact information. We will be checking our emails regularly, and we will reply to you within the following 24 hours.
Dear participants, the slides and the recording of this webinar will be also available on TPA Global website soon, so you can download it and review it again. Thank you,
Thank
everyone.
You.
Thank you, everybody, for the participation.